Every station on the radio is talking about it. Mike Tyson biting Evander Holyfield.
And these are supposed to be news stations.
So on Tuesday, I started calling a few of them, and I finally got through to one. A Bible talk station in Kentucky. And I managed to convince the screener that I was a behavioral psychologist who specializes in human-on-human biting. I told the guy that I'd done all this extensive research on people who chomp flesh under extreme stress. They put me on the air. I took calls for 45 minutes. It's kind of stupid. I know. It's silly. I'll probably just kill it. Does that mean you'll help me with it?
Marty Peretz, our boss. He's a little scary.
How about the commas and dates? Are we supposed to circle those, too?
There are good editors, there are bad editors. You'll have both. My hope for you, though, is that once, at least once, you get a truly great one. A great editor defends his writers against anyone. He stands up and fights for you. Michael Kelly was that kind of editor. He had that kind of courage, and that's what hung him.
We should have seen this coming.
The way he laughs whenever Marty tells a joke in the meetings, they're never funny, but there's Chuck completely howling. He's so political. And pissy? I mean, how pissy does he get whenever you try to fact-check one of his pieces? It's like, I'm sorry, but we have an obligation to get our facts straight.
Hey, so, sorry about, what happened when he left. I just didn't know what to do. Need a hand with the boxes, will be in my office.
So Chuck took over, and the job, for the first time ever, began to feel like a job. But I'm being unfair. The truth is, I wrote 14 pieces while Chuck was editing the magazine. And the last of them was the biggest story I ever wrote.
Is anyone interested in hackers? Because I met this kid named Ian Restel, biggest computer geek of all time. He hacked his way into the database of a company called Juked Micronics and posted naked pictures of women and the salary of every Juked employee on Juked's website with a note saying, "The big bad bionic boy has been here, baby." The guys at Juked decided that it would be cheaper to hire him as a security consultant than it would be to try to stop him. So they met with him last week at the hotel where the National Hackers Conference was taking place. It was the chairman from Juked, Restel, Restel's mother, and Restel's agent. Yes, hackers have agents too. All right, I was at the table with these guys. Restel's just laying out all of his demands. I want a trip to Disney World. I want a lifetime subscription to Playboy. And they're complying with every single word. After that, after they have the meeting, he goes back into the conference where all these hackers have gathered. And they're treating him like he's a rock star. Then Restel jumps up on a table and he's like,
it's a gyrating hip like this. I want a Miata. I want my Playboys. I want a trip to Disney World. Show me the money. Show me the money.
Turns out there are now 21 states considering versions of a law called the Uniform Computer Security Act, which would criminalize immunity deals between hackers and the companies they've torched. Meanwhile, Restel's agent claims a client list of over 300, one of whom was once paid $1 million and a monster truck. It's, really silly, I know. I'm not even sure if I'm gonna finish it. David, Christ's sakes. Don't hate me, okay? I'm trying to spare you a spanking, David. You've got blind quotes all over the place. Your facts are shaky. I mean, the line about the turnover at DOT was low by 4.5%. I checked. Robin Aaron would kill you over that kind of stuff. This is the New Republic, remember? Nothing slides here. If you don't have a cold, you don't turn it in, ever. Look, bring me your notes later and we'll go through it together. There's a lot about it that I like, really.
Now get back to work, okay? The mailroom floor needs scrubbing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But they're at home. Of course. Did I do something wrong? Are you mad at me? Okay.
Hey.
Well, Ian Restel emailed me right back. It might be a little tough to put you in touch with him directly, though. Or at least until next week. This is his email. Your story screwed up my deal. I don't to talk to you. I think he meant
I don't
want
to talk to you.
Yeah. I'm on vacation with my parents, so leave me alone. That's a good question. I guess you have to know his mom. She's a little quirky. That's his email address, if you want to write him yourself. These are all my notes. That's the number for the National Assembly of Hackers. Don't be thrown if all you hear is like a dark, deep, heavy breathing. It's,
I don't know, their outgoing voicemail message. Don't ask me why. And then that's the number for Juked Micronics. The chairman's name is George Sims. I can't figure out why this Pettenberg guy would have such a hard time finding it, but, you know, whatever. That's the URL to their website. And then I can't seem to find Joe Hyatt's number. I was looking all over at home, and it's somewhere there. I know it is, so I'll just get that to you tomorrow, if that's okay. He's Restel's agent. Should I, I'll give you some privacy. No, Silicon Valley. You'll probably get a voicemail, I usually do. They already have our number. I'm sorry. We've just, like, spoken a million times now. That's actually his voice on the answering machine. Sims is so hands-on that he won't even let his secretary do an outgoing message. Who's next?
Oh. David. Shit. What are you doing here?
Thank you.
Fine. I'm just Barry. No, I'm... Good night, David.
Chuck, it's Steve.
Hey, sorry to be calling so late. I was just wondering, did you get a call from the juked guy, George Sims?
Yeah, I was just sitting here, and I realized that I'd given him your home number without asking you first, and I wanted to apologize. Sort of a prick, didn't you think?
No, why?
Sure, sounds like a party.
Okay. Night, Chuck.
Hey.
Wanna laugh?
The website for Juked Micronics.
Yeah, you might not think so when you see what's on it.
I don't think Mr. Sims liked our piece that much.
Yeah. And I found this, too, on my fridge for some reason.
Ian Restel's agent, Joe Hyatt.
I'd like to pause for a moment. You can't really go into the world of journalism without first understanding how a piece gets edited at a place like TNR. This is the system that Michael Kelly brought with him from The New Yorker. A 3-day torture test. If your article's good, the process will only make it better. If your article's shaky, you're in for a long week. A story comes in, and it goes to a senior editor. He or she edits it on computer, then calls in the writer, who makes revisions. Then the piece goes to a second editor, and the writer revises it again. Then it goes through a fact check where every fact in the piece, every date, every title, every place or assertion is checked and verified. Then the piece goes to a copy editor where it is scrutinized once again. Then it goes to lawyers who apply their own burdens of proof. Marty looks at it too. He's very concerned with any kind of comment the magazine is making. Then production takes it and lays it out in column inches and type. Then it goes back on paper, then back to the writer, back to the copy editor, back to editor number one and editor number two, back to the fact checker, back to the writer, and back to production again. Throughout, those lawyers are reading and rereading, looking for red flags, anything that feels uncorroborated. Once they're satisfied, the pages are reprinted and it all happens again. Every editor, the fact checkers, they all go through it one last time.
Now, most of you will start out as interns somewhere, and interns do a lot of fact checking. So pay close attention.
There is a hole in the fact-checking system, a big one. The facts in most pieces can be checked against some type of source material. If an article's on, say, ethanol subsidies, you can check for discrepancies against the congressional record, trade publications, LexisNexis, footage from C-SPAN. But on other pieces, the only source material available are the notes provided by the reporter himself.